up? This is Robert. Welcome to Convict Inc. So it's Saturday right now. I just wanted to talk about what's been going on here in the last week. So Monday of this week, earlier after Monday, somewhere around, I guess it was between 5 and 6 after dinner, what happened was, okay, I'm laughing now. To put it in perspective, 4 D.C. homo thugs ran into a cell with a Slim Shady-inspired Caucasian who was getting tattooed by a former white supremacist-turned Muslim. Think about the different of, think about that for a second, what I just said, okay? So, anyway, 4 dudes ran in on him, and what it ultimately came out to be was a contraband robbery. So, dude got hit on the side, got punched up some, and nicked on the side with some sharp object. And, you know, because it was a white-on-black thing, let's not count the tattoo artist who was a Muslim, former white supremacist who jumped on the top bunk screaming. Let's forget about him. But when the white guys were coming back from the chow, the D.C. guys locked themselves in the cell for their own safety. And what had happened was when they were getting ready to take them to the shoot, nobody wanted to lock down. Everybody kind of wanted to jump on them, which caused a lot of problems in the pod. And what they do commonly in a, something like this is they grab pepper spray and they want to spray everybody down. You know, for a second it looked like that's what was going to happen, and then at the last minute people decided to lock in. I haven't been hit with this kind of, with this new pepper spray, to be honest. I haven't been hit with pepper spray since 97 when I got it straight hit to the face. They've since outlawed that type of pepper spray, so I don't know what this new stuff feels like, and I hope I don't. Anyway, so they immediately knew who the perpetrators were, who the guys that did the robbery were. They immediately knew everything. They knew everything from within an hour, okay? God knows how many people told, okay? Ran into the stuff to snitch. Who knows, okay? But what's been happening here all week is the U.S. Marshals had an audit. So I'm currently in a private prison. That means all of us have been bought by the prison. Marshals have contracted us out to the prison. We were sold by the United States government to a private prison. You can spin it any way you want, but that's the way it comes down to it. So the marshals were coming through here to see if they wanted to renew the contract. Do they want other slaves to own us, or do they want to put us in the Federal Bureau of Prisons, or slave masters, I should say? Do they want other slave masters to own us? Do they want the government to keep control? Do they want to let it, whatever? So what this warden that we have, by the way, I'll talk about him in a second, what this warden decided to do was use the audit to show them, well, this is how we handle lockdowns, we can do it this way, you know? So, and I kind of make fun of, I said something about him before, and he's actually not a bad guy. When I was making fun of before about the shirts being tucked in, and a couple audios back, I was talking about how he was more concerned about our uniforms and shirts being tucked in, and the cleanliness of ourselves, and people flopping on the ground of drug overdoses, or our K2 episodes, whatever you want to call them. I kind of said, I didn't give a fuck or whatever, but he's a military guy. He was in Operation Desert Storm. He's, you know, went through the VOP. He's rose to the ranks as warden, and now they come in to make big buku monies in these private prisons. But what the problem is he's like a troubleshooting warden, and they threw him in here because, let's face it, this place needs to be fixed in many ways. And I'm not criticizing staff here. And I'm going to say this, and I said it before, this place has its advantages for sure. So I have mixed feelings, I really do, about the private prison industry, because you can say whatever you want, they're buying prisoners, and that's kind of, there's something really sick about that. Now, let me go ahead and say what happened earlier. So this morning, or not this afternoon, I should say, two fellas got into it, Puerto Rican guys. One, just a lot smaller than the other, so he $150 the guy. What that means is they got a razor and cut his face open. Now the cut was so deep and so bad that they had to rush him out in an ambulance. So it looked like we're going to be on lockdown again. The warden did promise if there's another incident, we're going to be locked down for 30 days. So that we expected to be locked down. That's where you got the short from earlier. At first, I didn't know if it was a stabbing. It was a slicing, and it was from ear, the back of the ear, all the way to the lip. I've only seen one slicing worse than that, and that was on a guy named Bruce Neighbors, and I was a part of all that shit. And when they cut his face, the guy came up behind him with sardine can lids and sliced him from the back. He was from the back of the head, so from the lips towards the ear rather than from the ear towards the lips like this was. The guy, his name was Finn, sliced a guy named Bruce Mabers from the lips towards the ear, gave him a smiley face, scar on both sides, and his face actually fell down. You can see his molars and his teeth and stuff. That was reminiscent, this cut that I saw today was reminiscent of that. But this was actually caused by the lockdown. This is a transfer center. There are guys that are sitting here pre-trial going through cases in Texas and Oklahoma. Most of them are on indictments that have 40 people plus, okay? But what it is most of these people are coming through. Nobody had anything to do with the homo thug robbery. And you put guys in prison in cells with each other that don't know each other and lock them down unnecessarily. The people don't like to live with each other, so you can't. It's hard sometimes. So this was actually caused by the Marshall audit, the warden's decision due to the Marshall audit. I hope I just made sense. So just in case I didn't, let me go back and reflect. Marshall's audited it this week. They were doing training drills. Oh, by the way, I've got to tell you about this one. They were in the middle of training drills, and that's like doing CPR, like a fire alarms and stuff to show the marshals that they're so prepared. Well, during the middle of it, there was a girl who had a seizure. I thought she was 9 months pregnant having a baby. No, she just was sporting one of those Dollar General bods that are really popular amongst the girl population here, the female population here, and she had a seizure. And as they were running with her on the gurney, yeah, she started seizing and she fell. She started falling. They caught her midway. I was watching the whole thing out my back window. She didn't hit the ground. So, but it was, I'm sorry. She's okay, so I can say it was funny, okay? So, anyway. But they looked like they needed to be trained a lot better, to be honest. And, yeah, so anyway, I guess the highlight here is some violence going on in the low medium pod at Cimarron. This is an Alpha South. Yeah, so, and by the way, in the max pods, they carry knives. Everybody carries knives here. I mean, that's just, it's mandatory. They have Friday night heart checks, which are fights, which you go fight each other just for fun. That's what the whites do, just for rec. That's what they're doing the max pods, mandatory burpees, mandatory workout. So those guys are rocking and rolling over there. And yeah, so private printers industries. So before I go ahead and sign off, I just want to tell all you taxpayers, please put in a couple hours overtime this week so I can eat better pudding, because my pudding, I'm kind of tired of banana pudding. I'd like some chocolate. And yeah, take care. Bye.